It's an abstract argument, just goes through unchanged. And therefore, all of S plus U cohomology, all of the kernel of S plus U, is equal to Q cohomology. Okay? So the arguments saying that S plus U cohomology, the kernel of S plus U is Q cohomology, are the same as the arguments that we used for the kernel of S being Q1 cohomology. That part, those arguments are completely abstract and general. That was the advantage of being the abstract. The new isometric curve is that we could exactly compute Q1 cohomology. And, meaning the kernel of S, because that was so trivial. And find one-to-one map between the kernel of S and the kernel of S plus U.
Why is it obvious that there should exist a path between the kernel of S and the kernel of S?
Well, we've just done it, right? We've shown. Given any state size 0 that was annihilated by S, we have found the state size that is annihilated by S plus U. The reverse construction is also true. For the same reason, because you can write S plus U minus U. And the same thing goes through, it's the same argument. Okay? Basically this map between them, between kernels is a very general property of lower triangular matrices. Kernel of a lower triangular matrix. This lower triangular in the sense of under eigenvalue of NLC. Because this U has negative eigenvalue under NLC. So the kernel of a lower triangular matrix is isomorphic to the kernel of its diagonal elements. Let's just see that in the 2 cross 2 matrix. Yes. So suppose. Suppose we know the following. We know that we've got an eigenvalue 0 here. Well, it's even. Actually, it's going to seem trivial from this 2 cross 2 thing, but let me just say it. Okay, suppose we have 0 A, then what's the kernel of this matrix? It's a one dimensional kernel, and the kernel is all elements of the form alpha Z. Now, if you have 0 A B, and A is not equal to 0, then it's this lower triangular and the matrix, the diagonal thing was invertible apart from in this 0 block. Which is the structure we had, remember? S was invertible outside the 0 eigenvalue. Okay. Then it's clear that this element is no longer the kernel, but you can find what the kernel element is. Okay. Because in order for, let's look at alpha beta. So let's see. So 0, 0, the first condition gives you nothing, but the second condition gives you B alpha plus A beta is equal to 0. Now it's not true anymore that you can choose that you choose beta equal to 0, but beta is, you choose some alpha, and then beta is determined by B alpha by A. With the minus. Since A is not equal to 0, this is identified. Okay. So if you've got a lower triangular matrix, such that in this region, the space where you have no zeros here, this thing is non-invertible, and all elements in the lower triangular element, are like this. Let me say this right. Suppose you've got a matrix of this structure. But these are zeros. This is really zeros. Any dimensional matrix. Zeros, zeros, A and B. Then there's a one-to-one map between the kernel of this matrix and the kernel of the operator A. And that's exactly what we've done. You see, this operator A0 is S. A0B blah 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 is X plus U. It's lower triangular in the sense we're using an eigenbasis of NLC now. That's why this B comes down here, because it changes the eigenvalues of NLC. Okay? So you can just think of this in terms of matrices. In that term, it's totally obvious. Sometimes this abstract construction in sets of matrices is just an entirely obvious statement. Is this clear? This is isomorphisms between the kernels. Is this clear? Okay, fantastic. So, why are we concluding? Okay, there's one more thing that I want to remind you of, and that is that, okay, so we have therefore concluded that we have concluded two things. Firstly, we concluded that the cohomology of Q is equal to the kernel of Q plus S, of S plus U. We've concluded that the kernel of S plus U is isomorphic to the kernel of S, which was equal to the correct Hilbert space theory, like good quantization Hilbert. There's one more thing we have to worry about, that's inner products.
Yes, but inner products generally.
But let's worry about that. What I want to claim is, now suppose we got this map. Okay, I want to claim that the inner product between psi and, let's say we've got psi 1 and psi 2, let's call this chi 1 and chi 2. Now, let's try to compute the inner product between psi 1 and psi 2. Remember that every u, okay, lowers energy. Now, it's impossible to have non-zero, a contribution to the inner product from, if you have two states, both of which have NLC equals zero, and some operator in the middle, which has a negative value of NLC. Just because you won't be able to, you can try it. You won't be able to eat up all the oscillators. There will be some oscillators left over to annihilate one or two of those states. Okay? So, when you try to compute the inner product between psi 1 and psi 2, all terms that all you use give you 0. The only term that survives is equal to chi 1. So, with this particular map, we not only have produced a map that's an isomorphism between states, we've actually, in fact, produced a map that respects the inner product.
I understand that it will be proportional.
No, no, but with this one, it's exactly equal. Because everything else is just zero. Of course, we could have made it proportional by changing this constant to something else, by multiplying it. But with this choice of firm, with this one, it's equal. Okay? So, we have proved now the no-cost theorem in the strongest form. That is, states in Q cohomology are in one-to-one map with the states of a light cone oscillator, the states of the light cone quantization, transverse oscillations of the string, and all states in Q cohomology have positive definite inner product.
We don't have to worry about what happens if there's some operator in there. Some psi 1, some A, psi 2.
Yeah. Okay. Now, you see, that will require us to specify what kind of operators are.
Yeah. Yes.
That's a different level of. At the moment, we're just looking at the Hilbert space. We do have to worry about that, and then we look at string scattering amplitudes, but we will talk about it. Okay? But let's not be so ambitious at the moment. Okay. So, it's an incredible result and shows you the power of abstract mathematical reasoning. You know, I mean, if you were to actually try to enumerate this Q cohomology level by level, let's say, it's quite difficult. But abstract mathematical reasoning can sometimes give you very powerful results. You know, physicists like me tend often to dismiss this kind of abstract thinking is often pointless. Well, but one shouldn't take that too far. You know, it can be very useful sometimes. This is really an example. Okay, so the problem with our course is that it keeps getting interrupted. Next Friday there's a department meeting at 2:00. You guys have an alternate time you could find.
Or maybe it's okay.
Okay, we might try to come up with an alternate time offline, otherwise we won't have... So can I just take 15 minutes more now? Okay, we just keep getting interrupted, so let's then we get... Okay. Of course, those who want to leave, please go ahead. There's no penalty for that. Okay, let us just take 15 minutes more just to talk about the remaining things I wanted to talk about today. Okay, it could be that next time we meet is next Wednesday. Don't get too far. Okay, now... the next thing I want to do that I want to tell you about, the next thing I want to tell you about is about an explicit construction of states in Q-cohomology. You know, you might say this is pretty explicit, and it is explicit, but it involves this inversion of, you know, this action of 1 minus S inverse U S inverse. Well, this is really explicit. So this is less so, right? Because it involves acting with this operator and this U square model. Okay. Now, what I want to tell you about is a more explicit, it won't be totally, well, you'll see, it's a more explicit characterization of states in Q-cohomology, and it was in fact the first way that covariant quantization makes contact with what's called the old canonical quantization, which is one of the first ways in which covariant quantization of the string was done in analogy with the thumb law quantization of electric entities. So, it's a useful thing to keep in mind now. Okay, so so in order to get to that, I want to tell you about one property. I want to tell you about one property of the states that can be constructed by this construction. And the property is that these states all have zero eigenvalues under the operator 2n minus plus n c plus n. So clearly, consider the operator that counts the number of twice the number of minus oscillators, plus the number of C oscillators, plus the number of B oscillators. Okay? Now, the state that we construct by this construction always has zero eigenvalue under this operator. This is the claim. This is the claim that I want to justify. Okay, how do I justify this? Well, let's first count the eigenvalues of, let's first compute the eigenvalue of R. Let's remember what R is. So R was equal to k plus, 1 over k plus, sum over m, bm alpha plus minus. Okay, so now there are two kinds of terms. There are the terms with b, with this m index here being negative. That creates one B oscillator, but it destroys one minus oscillator. Because we have alpha with a plus index. Alpha plus with a plus index. It destroys a minus oscillator. So, such terms of R equals minus 1. Is that clear? Because it has n minus equals minus 1, and nb equals 1. On the other hand, you also have terms where this index goes negative. In that case, it creates a plus oscillator, so it doesn't carry any n minus. But if this index is negative, this index is positive, so it destroys the C oscillator, and therefore nc goes negative, is minus 1. In both cases, we have this quantity equals minus 1. So again, R has eigenvalue. Commutate of that operator with R is minus R. That's the statement, and you say we know what the. Yeah, okay. easiest way to see what you get is see what eigen, how much it will add to the eigenvalue of a state if you add it with. That's how we could do the computation. You can do it by doing the computation. Okay? So R is eigenvalue minus 1 under that operator. Now what about now I'm interested in Q0 and Q1. In the same way, Q1 has eigenvalue plus 1 under this operator. Okay? And you can easily check that because of this, or just directly check, that S has eigenvalue 0 under this operator. Okay? Well, what about Q0 and Q-1? Okay. Now, Q0 and Q-1 have terms of all kinds of values of R, or all kinds of values of this operator, but there is no term, okay, there is no term in either Q0 or Q-1 that has eigenvalue greater than plus 1 under this operator. This is my case. Now, the easiest way to check this is to try to produce a contradiction. You know, it's going to be important for what I say that this is true, that there's no double eigenvalue 2 or 3 or something like that. Okay? So the easiest way to check this is to try to produce a contradiction. So, you see, the place where you might most easily be able to produce a contradiction is to raise an n minus by a large number, by as much as you can, because of this factor 2. So maybe we should be looking at the path in C, okay, the path that is C minus M alpha plus minus alpha minus minus N alpha plus M plus N. Okay, so suppose N is, as written, is positive, then that will raise N minus by 1.
Sorry, what is this? This is some Q minus.
This is a contribution to Q.
Yeah, this is a contribution to Q, but this is not Q0 or Q minus 1.
But depending on what the values of M and N is, it's Q0 generally speaking. Right, because it has no zero oscillator. It could be a contribution to any. I'm going to claim that in all of Q, there is no term with the value of this operator being larger than 1. Okay? So in particular, we know that it's 1 for Q or Q1, but there's nothing that's larger. Okay, suppose n was positive, then this piece would raise this quantity by 2. But that must mean that either of these two is a destruction. Right, it can't be that all three operators are creation because the sum of the indices adds to 0. Okay? Suppose this guy was a destruction operator, then it would be destroying a minus oscillator. So it eats up the benefit of having this creation operator. This would be a creation operator, but it's just an eigenvalue 1. So there are pieces in which you get this quantity being eigenvalue 1, from this guy being creation, this guy being destruction, then this cancels, and you get 1 from here. Or you could have had this guy being creation, this guy being destruction. Sorry. This guy being creation, this guy being destruction. This creation just creates a plus operator that doesn't enter this operator. This creates a minus 1, this is eigenvalue plus 2, but this, because it's destruction, gives you an extra minus 1. So once again, you get 1. Okay? You examine all the terms, you convince yourself that there is no term with eigenvalue larger than 1 of this operator. Anywhere in Q. Therefore, the operator U. Therefore, the operator U has eigenvalue less than or equal to 0. Because U is equal to Q commutator R, R has eigenvalue minus 1, and Q has eigenvalue at most equal to 1. So U has eigenvalue less than or equal to 0 under this operator. Okay? But the operator by construction positive element. It's number of awesome, number plus number. Okay? And psi 0, the stuff that states in the kernel of S, have 0 eigenvalue. Under U, under this operator, because there's 0 eigenvalue under N plus N minus N C N B. Therefore, the states that we get by acting with the series S will have 0 eigenvalue under this operator. Therefore, the states that we get by acting with 1 plus S U inverse plus S U inverse S U inverse all have 0 eigenvalue under this operator, because the eigenvalue is less than or equal to the eigenvalue of the state that we start with, but there's no eigenvalue less than 0. Okay? So we conclude that the construction that we have yields a state in the kernel of this operator. Is this clear? Construction operators. You know, an operator can have negative eigenvalue under this operator. A state cannot. Let me repeat the argument. U has negative eigenvalue under this operator. So the state psi 0 has 0 eigenvalue under the operator. S has 0 eigenvalue under the operator. Has negative or 0. U has negative or 0. Okay. So if we consider the state we get by this series operation of 1 plus S inverse U plus S inverse U, S inverse U, the eigenvalue of the state must be less than or equal to 0. Right? Because act with this operator on that state, U, S leaves it unchanged, U lowers it. But there's no state with eigenvalue less than 0. So the the parts which have negative u must annihilate the state. That's clear, right? Because it can come with a lot of destruction operators.
Basically, we'll be looking at the operator S inverse U, which has negative eigenvalue.
Right. Which has eigenvalue either 0 or pieces that are 0 and pieces that are negative.
There is no singularity over here due to the S having 0
eigenvalue.
No,
the state we're looking at was well defined. That we've already argued.
Right.
So there's no question about the state being well defined.
Right.
Okay? It's just a question of what the eigenvalue of the state is under this operator. Must be decomposed to states with the eigenvalues less than or equal to 0. This is clear, right? But there's no state with eigenvalue less than or equal to 0. Less than 0. So the states must have eigenvalue equal to 0. Okay? Therefore, we conclude that all our states, all the states that we've got by this construction, obey the condition N minus on psi is equal to 0, NC on psi is equal to 0, NB on psi equal to 0. going to focus on is these two things. What we have shown here is not only does there exist, you know, not only have we characterized Q cohomology, we've also shown that there is a representative of the cohomology that is made up entirely out of the matter oscillators of the theory. Because in this representative, we have no C oscillators and no B oscillators. Okay? So now, in the next 10 minutes, next 5-10 minutes, we're going to study states. We're going to study states of this form. We're going to study the states of the form states that are in the C and B vacuum. So arbitrary matter states, but C, B vacuum.
Size
and things can only consist of transverse oscillators, plus
transverse
oscillators. Plus, that's correct. Size, and exact, created exact, only with transverse oscillators and plus oscillators. And the point is that how many plus of what, given the transverse oscillator structure, the plus oscillator structure is different. It's not an independent. No, that's because it took a state with only transverse oscillators and then dressed it with plus oscillators to put it in the cohomology. It's possible to do that. Okay? But in particular, it's possible to state two states in the cohomology of Q that are entirely in the BC host vacuum. Okay? So let's study states of this sort. Okay. So let's suppose we've got a state that is in the BC host vacuum. Okay? And we act on it with Q. Okay? What does it mean for the state to be Q closed? Well, you see, because Q has pieces that look like C M L minus M, sum over all. Okay. Now, if we choose M to be, let's call it minus M. If we choose M to be negative, we'd have a C destruction, which annihilates states of this sort. Okay, so if we're concentrating the states in this form, states that are in the B and C coast vacuum, then we only get contributions from N in being positive. And so what we get? We get C minus M on psi, which is something, times L M on psi. So C minus M gets L on psi. The C minus M just acts in the coast vacuum immediately. But this must be zero if the state is to be in Q cohomology. Therefore, the state must be annihilated by M. The matter part of the state. But for positive M.
Right.
For positive M, but actually including 0.
Zero. Yeah.
Because C0 on psi is not 0. Okay? So we conclude that if we're interested in states of Q cohomology of the form, some arbitrary state in the matter conformal field theory, times BC ghost vacuum, then LM on psi must be equal to 0 for all m greater than equal to 0. That's the first thing. Okay.
So we have just obtained the states of the vacuum.
Wait, we still have to mod out the 0 now states.
The 0 now. Okay.
Hang on. Almost. So we've constructed. You see, this is necessary and sufficient for the state to be in Q cohomology. Sorry, to be Q closed. But some states of this form might be Q exact. Okay? So the states that are Q cohomology of this form are states that are annihilated by all Lm, which is M positive. But we may also have some Q exact states. Now remember that Q exact states have the property that they have zero inner product in any physical Q state. And by the no-ghost theorem, we've shown that any state that has that is physical, that is annihilated by Q, and has zero inner product with all other states, in particular zero norm, must be Q exact. Because we showed that there are, that within Q cohomology, there are no, we've got a positive definite in the product. There are no zero obsoletes. Okay? So, if we want to identify the states that are Q closed, sorry, that are Q exact among these. So, physical states, states that are Q closed, are states that are bigger. But not all of these states are in Q cohomology, because we still have to remove the Q exact states. In order to remove the Q exact states, well, basically it's states of, you know.
So, just one thing. This state is the oscillator correspond to the total T.
To the?
Total T.
No, no, it's just by matter.
The magnet.
Just the magnet.
Okay.
Yeah. There's also the ghost part, but that doesn't contribute. That kills.
That first kills the vacuum.
That kills the
vacuum. Oh, that. Oh, I
see. Because it's the vacuum in the ghost. In the ghost thing. Apart from a normal ordering cost. Actually, it gives you minus one on the vacuum, which makes it this L0 minus one. So, apart from the normal ordering. Okay? Fine. So, now, you can do this more systematically, but an easy way to try to identify all states that are Q-exact is to just identify all states that are of this form that are zero norm. Now, what states can you find of this form that are zero norm? Let's try to use the same kind of reasoning that we used for Q cohomology. You remember that states that were zero norm were simply Q on something else. So suppose we had states that were L minus N on some target. Suppose we had psi that was this. Now let's compute the inner product of psi with any psi phase. Let's call it A phase. Let's compute this inner product. So this is equal to chi L plus N. A plus is equal to zero. Because LN annihilates every physical state. So if you have a state that is a descendant, that is L minus N of some other state, such a state can sometimes also be primary. Okay, so let me introduce some terminology. States that are annihilated by all LNs for N's positive are called primary states. States that are obtained from some other state by the action of L minus N, but for N positive, are called descendant states. Now, if you have a state that is both primary and a descendant, a state that is both primary and a descendant, it has zero norm. And therefore, is in Q cohomology. Is not in Q cohomology. I mean, it's Q exact. You can basically show that I won't try to do it. That this exhausts the set of Q exact states of this form. Okay? So, if we're looking just at the matter sector, okay, if we're looking just at the matter sector, then the states that are Q exact are states that obey all the physical state conditions, but are also descended from some other state. Now, there's a very pretty structure of representation theory that underlies all of this, that some of you are very familiar with from the study of superconformal analysis. You see, when a state goes zero norm, it is both a descendant and a primary. It's at the head of its own tower, own representation of the algebra, but it's also descended from some other primary. So, and it's these states that are unphysical. They're zero norm states, they're unphysical, they should be thought of as being pure gauge, as we will see in various examples. Okay? So from the point of view of the matter conformal theory, the equivalent of Q cohomology is the statement, consider all states that are primary, annihilated by all LNs with N positive, modulo states that are descendants. Okay, that is the version of Q-cohomology that descends down to this little subsector. Okay, now I think we've gone on for far too long. What I also plan to do is to work out both Q-cohomology and this matter cohomology in at low levels for the string theory. Well, to be frank, just at the master's level. Can I leave it to you as an exercise and actually hope somebody might do it? I'm going to suggest it to you as an exercise, and we'll very quickly rush through it next class, and whenever that may be. Next class may just well be next Wednesday, and after that, now turn to a serious study of the properties of the formula we looked at before sketching it.